So I would like to start by thanking the organizers for giving me this opportunity to present this work today. So we've been working in my group for on HD Selects experiments for more than, I think, 5 years now. But we are coming at it, as Uwe mentioned, from a different angle. We're not looking, our motivation to look at the data was not because of transcription factor binders, but we are coming at it from the drug development side. And because the angle is a little bit different, I would like to spend a few words perhaps to mention some of the details of the process itself. So the goal of the SELECT experiment, as was initially designed, and as the name indicated, the systematic evolution of ligands by exponential enrichment, is starting with a random pool, and initially that random pool was of RNA molecules that will be a candidate ligand and a target. Our goal is to select from this pool molecules that bind to the target. Now, for the most of the transcription factor studies, this is being replaced by the double-stranded DNA, which makes the process, even if Eric complained about it, a little more clean. So we start with this. The random pool is really not fully random in the sense that there is a randomized regions that is flanked on both sides by constant sequences that are being used during the procedure for amplification and other stuff. The increase of the application, so the procedure itself, the SELECT procedure has been first proposed in 1990, and now we have really explosion of interest in applying it in different contexts. And part of that explosion is due to combining the original design of HD SELECTs with the next generation sequencing. So currently, we look in the PubMed, there's more than 1,000 papers that use SELECTs. And this being like compared to in 2000 was only 80, and the thing seems to be growing quite rapidly. So a little bit about the procedure. So as many of you know, but I'm going to go very briefly over it. So the idea is we start with this pool of the randomized RNA sequence. Of course, we don't really have initial RNA library, but DNA library that is being transcribed to RNA. Then that RNA pool is being incubated with the target of interest. The things that do not bind is washed away. The things that is being bind is now separated, and then the bound RNA separated from the target molecule is being amplified, and then the cycle repeats. Now, the idea of what next generation sequencing brought is that any time during this cycle, initially that was done only at the end, but in practice, at any time of the cycles, you can go and partition the pool that goes to the next cycle and take part of it at sequence, and therefore you know what's in the pool, and hopefully you can learn from that.
Yeah. Is there any risk of hybridization between the RNA sequences during the incubation?
Yeah.
Could happen?
Yeah. You know. Yes, it could happen, and in fact, you know, we in certain situation, not in the HD SELECTs, we are designing actually a Lego block things that will not hybridize, and that you know people are used to develop drugs. And I may mention a little bit at the end. So, what are the targets? So, one very frequent target is a protein, and you've seen a lot about a design where the target is transcription factor. It could be also some RNA binding molecule, but in the medical setting, usually those things are receptors. Other, this is actually the application that we kind of start with is small molecules, and what you can do here, maybe I actually progress this a little bit. I wanted to mention that actually there is currently one drug that is an aptamer, is Macugan. It's a drug for age-related macular degeneration. Sorry for the pronunciation. And then the target of this drug is actually cytokine that is being secreted in too big of amount in during this disease and stimulates some of the receptors that shouldn't be stimulated in this amount. So it's neutralized, the cytokine. Another important application that I've been always put forward as the kind of driving force of the experiment is to construct those RNA so that you can replace antibody. This is still a goal that's to be achieved. And there's a reason for it. It's certainly, if it can be worked out, it would be a much simpler procedure, and then RNAs would be more stable than the antibody. And we've seen a lot of application to RNA and DNA binding motifs. For the small molecules, of course, it's molecular testing. You would like to say whether in the blood you have some undesired, say, you know, molecule, then you can test it. A lot of attention now is given to what is called cell selects. And there are two basic reasons, and this is much of the work that I'm going to present today is related to the cell selects. So there are two major reasons for which you would like to do that. One, and this is work of some of our collaborators, is to be able to recognize in the organism cells that are being responding to some pathogen, such as Ebola infection. So you would like to grow aptamers that would differentially bind to cells that are infected versus to the ones that are not. And the second is again a very interesting concept is to use aptamers for targeted drug delivery. So initially where aptamers were designed, the first drug was proposed, the assumption was that the only way aptamers can be used in drug development is when they can target either cytokine or, say, receptor, but there's no way to bring them into the cell. However, now many groups start to develop a procedure that will help to internalize aptamers. And the idea is that to use the biological process of endocytosis, so specifically if certain receptors are stimulated, then they will create this pit, and then that pit will encapsulate whatever it takes and travel inside the cell. So the idea now is to develop aptamers that will target particular receptors. And also you hope to do it in a very specific way that will target receptors in the cells that you would like to target, but not the other cells. And on top of that, you know, if you develop those aptamers, they are really not necessarily your drugs. You want to use those aptamers as cargo to which you can attach, say, sRNA. That would be, you know, the thing that you want to deliver. Okay. So now... when Eric mentioned that he really doesn't like the HC selects because it's so messy, and that was on for transcription factor, this is getting, you know, much...
And I don't understand it
yet. Yeah, so that's even worse here. So the thing is, of course, that now we assume that if you look at the cell selects, we don't really assume that they would be just one place where the RNA can bind. So there would be this complex energy, say, landscape, binding landscape, and you kind of hope that during the procedure you will remove, so assuming that high affinity binders are here in this vial, you kind of hope that you remove the things that do not bind, and you amplify things that bind, and because you you know, do it repetitively, that things that bind the best have the higher count. Yes? No. So this is actually observation that many people done before. We just perhaps did it with a larger set of aptamers, namely 40. So this is the following the selection procedure for interleukin 10, which is an important molecular target. We simply, after eighth selection cycle, we simply sorted all the aptamers by their frequency, and then our collaborators who actually performed this experiment also decided to say, okay, we'll test subset of them. So they tested top five, something in the middle, and they refused to test anything at the bottom of the list. So here it is, we have KD values, there are things of them as arbitrary units, and anything more than, say, you know, 200 is basically very, very weak or non-binding. So when you see when we sorted them by the frequency, the correlation between frequency and binding is certainly not great. Of course, many people, you heard here that the other possibility would be, rather than looking at the frequency, take the enrichment. So here we take enrichment between two last cycles, and the things are definitely much better, but still not perfectly. So with the understanding that the data is really complex, we set ahead to try to perhaps use this big data set in trying to understand what is distinguishing binders from non-binders. And because of the specific interest of the groups that we collaborate with in RNA aptamers, and in fact, in particular in drug development, so developing aptamers that will be very specific, we focus on aptamers that binding mode aptamers that will, for which we assume that both sequence and structures are being important. So of course, so why sequence and structure is important, RNA binding proteins, for many of them, and this is one example, it's being recognized that structure is an important component. For our poster child, the macrogen drug, it also works in very particular structures, and understanding the structure was kind of important to modify certain bases so that to increase the stability of the drug. What's different, and I still do not quite understand, is that when you take a RNA binding molecule and you perform SELEX experiment, you really even don't need to cycle and you get a motif. For the end of the examples, for the for the molecules that haven't been evolutionally designed to be RNA binding, we never see any selection before cycle 4. And that's a kind of what it's also, there's during the selection, there's lots of accumulation of various artifacts. So that's not really very good that we have to keep, you know, amplifying those artifacts. But nevertheless, I assume that this is related to the evolutionary design of those proteins that bind RNA, you know, like various splicing factors, etc. But maybe it's just the technical details of the experiment are better work out. I don't really know. So anyway, so one way, of course, to look into this to understand the what's going on is to take this selection process and sequence perhaps all the cycles in a very deep sequencing and try to identify what the binding motifs and what the binding properties might be. So there are previous methods that look at the sequence structure motifs, starting with a work from our collaborators. Memories, which is based on the MIMI motif finding approach, and here the kind of information that's being used is to look at the RNA, predict which binding probability of every single base pair, and then run MIMI type of algorithm, starting with biasing it towards regions that are single-stranded. And this is because of the assumption that the binding motifs would be typically in the single-stranded region. So we tried, but that it's just not designed to such a big set, so we couldn't really run it. Another very, very nice approach is RNA context that works quite well for RNA binding proteins, but it has, again, it doesn't scale. It doesn't work with the large data, very large data. It works with quite large data. And also it assumes that there is a single motif, which is not what we assume. And that's an important assumption. Previously, we developed APTA motif. And again, we fail in having this being scalable. And it's again make an assumption that is good for RNA binding proteins that there's one or maybe two motifs, but again, not many. So we decided to develop some complementary approach. And what I'm going to describe to you is what we call APTA trace. And this is work that will be presented in this coming recomp. So what we are assume, and this is very important assumption for this method, is that both sequence structure matter. If we have a motif that's only important because of sequence, we won't find it. If it's, we have a motif that's important only because of structure, we won't find it. This is a real focus on sequence and structure motifs. And also, the basic principle of the whole design is the assumption that we have the selection process that iterates, and if a motif is being selected for, sequence structure motif is being selected for, then if we compare the population of aptamers that are enriching the pool versus the ones that are not, then this particular structural biases should increase more and more. And let me be more specific what I really mean by that. So for every aptamers, we have to look at its structure. And then for every, now we use here the Kamer approach, as many people did before for sequences, except we decorated with the structural information too. So this is, in some way, this is also what RNA context did. So for every aptamers, we consider a sample of all possible structures for that aptamer, and then for every kamer, we have a sliding window over the structures, and to identify on the kamer and see what is the probability of the kamer to be in this particular context in any of the secondary structures. So specifically, we focus on pair hairpin internal loop in bulge and also unstructured region. So for every kamer in every aptamers, we compute those probabilities. And then if we look over all the, if you have a set of aptamers, we can, of course, combine those into one vector.
So just to clarify, so the longer sequences in your data set, you fold them one by one, and then you...
We do all 100 million sequences, we fold them.
Okay.
And not only that, we don't look on the minimal free energy structure, but we use a single S-fold so that we have a probability distribution to the extent to which S-fold does it, right? So it's not completely perfect program to do it, but it's a faster one we could do it. And just to put you the scale of the whole thingy, in this particular the experiment that was actually motivated us to go after and develop a new approach, it has 40 millions of okay. I'm not sure when I got the zero end. But anyway, it's like enormous number amount of read per cycle. I think it was 40 million. So then the idea is that if we look at the what we call K context, and we look at it, how it changes over the selection cycles, we are looking at those K-mers that as you move in the selection cycles, the context is shifting. So it's selecting for something. So this is the really main idea of the approach, and how that's being executed is again as we say we start with the pool with a pool of all aptamers, and let's this box would be K telling you what we do with one cycle. So then for each aptomers, as you ask, we predict all the secondary structure. Now, it's important and when we predict secondary structures, not only randomized regions that takes part, but also those flanking regions, because those are in the solution when we do the binding. And unlike in case of the binding motifs, if we know more or less what we look at, we can somehow avoid that we don't have a binding motif in the flanking regions. But if we look at the structure, actually, I think almost all the experiments we look at eventually end up to involve this constant region in some sort of hairpin. So we look at the whole aptamers, including not only random regions, but also the flanking constant regions. We predict the structure. We, for every k-mer, we look what is the structural preference of that k-mer in that particular aptamers. Now, a k-mer has k nucleotides, so we don't really assign the preferences for every nucleotide. We just average over the k-mer, where the k-mer, what is the structure that k-mer likes. And then we take, you know, we take all the k-mers over all the aptamers, and that is our k-context here. So now, once we have a k-context, we would like to have a score that will define whether or not this k-context is shifting towards some new, so starting with some background distribution, whether it's shifting towards something else. So that means that we repeated this procedure for every cycle, round one up to round n, and then we compute the k-context for a given aptamers for every single round. So now we have this k-context. We would like to do somehow score it. So what to score it, we would like to, a natural way is if you have two probability distribution to compare this is to use relative entropy. So this is what we do. And basically, we compute relative entropy between every pair of cycles and sum it up. So this is how we compute the score. Now, we need to have some statistical significance to decide whether the score is significant or not. So in order to do it, we really, when we compute all this k-mer, we really separate them into two pools. The ones that we are going to look at as compute the scores, and one which are going to consider to be background. So we simply use a count cutoff, and anything I think below 10 or was considered to be a background. So we compute this k-mer shifting score for all this background that gives us this distribution, and then we simply pick as k-mer of interest those k-mers that are on the tail of this distribution. Now, those we call them k-mer seeds because, of course, we do it over and over again. Then you may have k-mers that are very similar. So we then if this is a seed we select, then we go over all other statistically significant k-mer and we build a more complex profile. We align those seeds with some threshold here. But when we align the seed, we make sure that we only align seeds that are sequentially similar and have the same structural preferences. So at the end of the day, we are going to come with a list of the k-mers or actually profiles of k-mers that have this statistically significant shift in their structural preferences. And this is what we report after some additional filterings that I will mention. So we wanted to know how well we are doing. And previously, we developed AptaSim, a program to simulate HT selects data. Our initial program didn't have any structural information in this, but in general, it starts with a initial library that we generated using first-order, second-order hidden Markov model, because the library actually, although it's assumed to be random, but it's really not. You may assume see that in the libraries often constructed, you have enrichment of T's followed by T, and this is related, apparently, we've been told by the producer, that's related to reactivity of T. So we use hidden Markov model to start with the library. Then we simulate selection process. We simulate amplification process together with polymerase errors, and then we pull select a sub certain fraction to go to the next cycle. So the new to in this simulation program was that we now also added, basically we planted some of the structural motifs and gave them selective advantage. So we simulated this on 4 million of sequences. This is an order of magnitude less than what we have in the experimental data. So we planted here those motifs. This percentage here, I'll forget that those are percentage, but they kind of are giving us like kind of selective advantage that we gave those aptamers. So this sorts them according to the advantages. And then out of the many programs that look for any sort of motifs, we actually found out that Dreamy is one. This is not a sequence structure, it's a sequence motifs, but which is the one that could handle such a big data up to a certain point. I mean, it couldn't handle our data, but it could handle when we take 10% of it. So you could see we can, of course, Dreamy doesn't have the concept of the selection, so we just look at whatever we see at the end of the cycle and see what motifs can be found here. So here's after trace when we look at all the cycles, and then this is here just when we just look at the last cycle, so we forget about all the selection procedure and just assume that we have just two steps. Of course, they would be also some false positives. So we have here a rock curve. So here's the rock curve for the APTA trace. I think it got one false positive in between. Dreamy couldn't really, finish it. Those are the only two motifs that it got within the 50 cycles when we got 50 best motifs when we extended the, give it a couple of more days to run, it was able to produce 100 best motifs, and within 100 we had a third one coming. Okay, so on the real data, again, we ran it now on the, this is a cell selects data. So we find a relatively large number of those of statistically significant motifs. So we pull them together. We know that the aptamers that have those motifs are binders. We are yet to prove that this binding is due to those motifs. So these experiments are being outgoing, and I'm kind of running out of time. So one important question, and this is actually a question that a Recomp reviewer posted to us, saying, you are really, making all this effort to analyze this huge data, but maybe you could just take a smaller sample from Celex and just analyze a smaller data. So what we did here is, this is like a trade-off. Those are the rounds here, and here is our downsampling of the initial pool, 5%, 10%, 20%, and all of the initial pool. And we're trying to see what is the trade-off between how much you sequence versus how many cycles you need. And the goal here is not so much to reduce the sequencing, because sequencing is cheap, but it's to reduce the number of cycles, maybe it's not so much more expensive. They are more expensive, at least now, but they are really generating problems. So the less cycles you have, the less of those amplifications, the less artifacts you collect.
What's the vertical axis?
So the vertical axis are our significance k-mers that we found by our procedure. And if we do tamer seeds or profiles, they like merged them into class or the clusters already, this, the results are the same. So in round one, as I said, we don't get anything. Up to round actually three, we get something. The peak is here at round four, where if we sequence really deeply, we'll get most of the stuff. So that basically, this is something that we're going, you know, we are reporting back to our collaborators and say, you know, really, you know, we don't need to go all the way up because we really get most of the stuff, at least for this particular experiment in round four. Now, I'm not, the round four is, round four that's being sequenced. There was this big spike is here, is, I guess, because they gave up and they sequenced a little bit at the beginning cycle. I think there were three of them here skipped, and then is this one. And then, you know, we get some additional return as we go on. But of course, you have to be careful whether this is additional returns or we are starting to pick the artifacts. So, you know. Now, with that, I would like to summarize that we developed an abstract trace that can successfully retrieve sequence structure binding motif of HD selects data. The things that I have to say, the things that APTA trace is not doing, it's not really basing its finding on any type of how many k-mers you have. And that may be a good thing to add, but it's not. And then the idea is to look at the motifs that are selected for. And as I say, that what we see here that it's better to have ultra deep sequencing because then you don't have to go so far with the cycling. So we have, over the years, we've developed a number of softwares in our group. This is the APTA trace that I focus today. What we are in preparation are APTA blocks. Those are the building blocks that avoid an RNA sticking to each other. And I would like to acknowledge that the APTA trace was being done by Feng Dao and Jan Koinka with help of EJ1 in my group. Is involved in APTA blocks. Our main collaborators in this project were people from City of Hope, specifically John Burnett, John Rossi, one of the pioneers of Celex experiment, and people experimentalists in their groups. From Freiburg University, we work with RNA guru Rolf Backhoff and Fabrizio Costa, and the initial analysis of interleukin 10 was done with collaborators from University of Miami, Elvi Gilboa and Alex Beresnoy. And thank you.
Maybe I'll start off with a question then. So you are actually running S-folds and then multiple subclusters over these millions of sequences.
Our farm is super busy.
Okay.
So I mean but you know, if we, of course, you know, S-fold is doing this sampling, right? So, and it's actually the faster one that is available. But you know, we do, first of all, we it's not really we multiply by 10 because the same aptamers are over and over again. So we first, so there's less of them, right? It's not, right? Especially at the end where we basically have all this exponential enrichment, we have, but we have also experiments that have been done technically quite different using so-called droplet PCRs, and then you don't see exponential enrichment, which we are yet to figure out why. So there's a lot of it, but we have big farm. So this is distributed to all our computers in NCBI and around overnight. If nobody kills it, we good.
There's a new cycle left behind.
NCBI cycle left behind.
Tried using something slightly simpler like PL-fold and just look whether paired unpaired is enough, because that seems to be the trend, right? That you sort of go to a hairpin.
I don't know. I think at this point we prefer not to. The reason is you know, what I didn't say is like this motif here. There's a beautiful motif which has multi-loop branch. So we've been so interested in it, and then we look at it, and this is a passenger motif. And what's happening is that our aptamer really like this hairpin, and they like another hairpin on another side was left. So at this point, we still would like to understand what's going on in terms of, we don't understand much of the procedure itself. In particular, even if you don't have any target, you will see some enrichment towards more structure, for example. So we want to keep it this way for now, but you're right. We have to simplify it as much as we can, make some sampling. But I mean, we don't expect people to have a farm in the basement. Yeah.
I should understand in the beginning, so Dream doesn't use the K context.
No, the it's just Dream. The Dream, what Dream got is based on the sequence, because we enriched for this particular sequence structures, but the sequence itself was enriched.
In the end, for those ones where you do agree, what was the relationship between affinity and amount of sequence? There was this disagreement initially. You started with affinity, when tested later, didn't agree with sequence, but then you were agreeing on your model, so it feels like maybe they are.
So here, the most frequent. Okay, I put one thing under the carpet. I have to admit. So this is a cell selects. And in this cell selects, we are interested in binding to particular cell expressing particular receptor and not to a null cell, which does not. So we have our selection is more complex. We have a selection followed by counter selection. So first we select stuff that bind to the cell, one cell, then we take what it binds, throw it on the others, and take what it doesn't bind. So things are more complicated. But nevertheless, the most frequent aptamer binds really well to our target cell and binds what a little bit still to the other one is not supposed to. So this is a trade-off that we are looking for here. We are yet to selected certain additional aptamers, so they are really synthesizing it, and we'll see what they bind. But it looks definitely less random than our interleukin 10.